Hi, everybody. I want to take a few minutes to point out some things I want you thinking about when you're reading the Foster Wallace essay. So first off, be sure that you go into the analysis document that I have attached in Canvas for the Foster Wallace essay, and make sure you go through and read through these questions. So under step one, I have a whole bunch of why questions, and then I have a whole bunch of strategy questions. Make sure you read through these questions before you start reading your Foster Wallace article, so that when you see these questions kind of coming up, you can go ahead and annotate your article. That way you can kind of pay attention to the different instances in which these different things are happening in the text. So that's my first recommendation. Be aware of what these questions are before you read so that you can properly annotate your text. The second thing is I want to talk about the rhetorical context. So that's our second step of when we're doing rhetorical analysis, is we got to think about the rhetorical context. And there are those seven questions that we want to consider. For Foster Wallace, where the article appeared is really important. So the article appeared in Gourmet magazine. And so we want to think about, I'm going to kind of move into question three here as well. To whom do you think the author is writing? Well, I want to think a little bit about who bothers to read Gourmet magazine. And so when we kind of think about that question, we're going to see that probably we use the word foodies, right? So people who really enjoy food, love the aesthetics of food, really like to eat, interesting or more intricately prepared food. And so we want to kind of think about what are those people going to be thinking about Foster Wallace's argument about lobsters, and earlier on Foster Wallace's kind of portrayal of the Maine Lobster Festival. So really kind of thinking about readers of Gourmet, and in particular when we think about who the author is writing to, you know, his thesis concept is ultimately, hey, you know, maybe we should be questioning whether or not we should eat lobsters. Is it really ethical? In his research, he seems to say, you know what, I really want to continue to enjoy to eat lobsters, but now that I've thought through all these questions, I don't know if I still can. He's hoping his audience goes through a similar kind of personal exploration. I really like to eat lobsters. He knows that because they are readers of Gourmet magazine. But once they know all this stuff, once they are aware of all the kind of complicated ethical questions, perhaps the next time they're not going to be able to eat lobster without kind of thinking through these different questions. He wants his audience to start questioning that. So when we think about an audience's kind of reception of that thesis on a scale of either friendly to that idea or resistant to that idea. Now we know readers of Gourmet magazine probably aren't going to be friendly to that. Maybe readers of some sort of animal rights magazine would be really friendly to that thesis idea. But with his audience, he knows his target audience is going to be somewhere on that resistant end of the scale. So they're going to be somewhat you know, kind of not wanting to be challenged because they like to eat lobster. We know that Foster Wallace isn't trying to reach people who are at the absolute end of that scale, people who are hostile to this thesis idea. So somebody who would just say, you know what, don't bother me, I'm going to eat what I want to eat because I like to eat it. Those aren't the people he's trying to reach, because he sets this whole thing up as it's a matter of what your interests are. And so he's hoping to reach people who are interested, who are curious, who are willing to read footnotes and try to learn more about this topic. So those are really important things to kind of think about as you're reading through it. Foster Wallace's purpose is really important. Don't make the mistake that he's trying to convince. He's not trying to convince or persuade people not to eat lobsters. He's merely trying to get them to think about these issues, ask these questions. That's what he's trying to do. So he's really on that provoke a thought of those four types of general purpose. Remember, we have to inform, to entertain, to provoke a thought, and to persuade. He is not trying to persuade, he's just trying to provoke. So it's really important to keep those things in mind. Okay, and then you want to go through these other steps as well. But when we're doing our annotation here, I use a tool called Annotate. I'll put a link in the assignment, but it's just annotate.com. And that's what I've used here to mark up this. I'm going to share my annotations with you guys, so you can go ahead. I'm going to give you the link so that you can come in and to take a look at these comments that I've made on the essay, but you also will need to set up an account. So it's a free account, you can set that up, and then you're welcome to use this tool as well. I think it's one of the easier ones to use. So I set up my annotations in here. I created I created a bunch of tags on this. So you're going to see here as I was annotating for each one of these, like number one is marked over here, pay attention to the language choices. He calls this well marketed. Here he sets up this class difference between rich people, Camden, and then working class, which is the Rockland. Pay attention to, you can kind of go through, I'll just give you guys this link and I'm not going to read all my annotations to you right now, but you can go through and read all these different annotations. I've just highlighted some of the big things that I want you guys to pay attention to. And you'll see some of them are tagged as pay attention to the language. Some of them are tagged as pay attention to motive development or ethos. So pay attention to kind of not only what I'm writing in the tag, I'm sorry, what I'm writing in the comment, but also what tag I've attached to it. So I'm going to go ahead and share these with you. And you can take a look at those annotations. Pay attention that for Foster Wallace, his argument is kind of broken into two big sections. I like to call this thing a sneak attack, where when readers open this up, I gave you guys exactly what it looked like when it was originally published in Gourmet Magazine. It's in this field notes section, regular section of the magazine. That means it's going to be some reporter giving a report on some aspect of culinary delight in the field. And so that they go, you know, readers open this up and they're going to learn about the Maine Lobster Festival. So Foster Wallace reports on the Maine Lobster Festival, but we, after we've read the article, know that's not his real purpose. His real purpose isn't just to report on the Lobster Festival. It's really to get to this question that he gets here on page 56. Not on page 56, the next page. Okay. So when he gets to here, so here's a question. So here's the kind of the big divide here. Before this question, the whole thing is this reporting on the Maine Lobster Festival. We have to ask ourselves, what is he doing when he's reporting on the Maine Lobster Festival? What is he trying to accomplish with his target audience? So in that first section, he's just trying to establish common ground because he knows that his audience is going to be resistant to this question that he ultimately gets to. Is it all right to boil a sentient creature alive just for our gustatory pleasure? Now, readers of Gourmet, that's what they love to eat, all kinds of different interesting foods, right? Any type of animal included in that. And so he knows his audience is going to be resistant to this. So he spends this whole first part of this argument here to kind of establishing common ground, and pay attention to how he is establishing that he too is like them. He being Foster Wallace, has the same type of aesthetic appreciation. Foster Wallace, in order for him to write something like these people are walking around with bobblehead dolls and inflatable lobster tools, and when they go into to the Maine Lobster tent to eat, they're eating off styrofoam and the coffee is convenience store coffee. Think about readers of Gourmet and how he's describing that. They're going to be like, ooh, that's kind of gross. Eating off styrofoam and plastic utensils. And then when he gets into this thing here about how the, you know, what the people are doing. So people kind of, you know, block their tables and kind of make sure that only, you know, save the tables for their friends. The way he kind of talks about kids here, when he says, when you're squeezed into benches alongside children of various ages and vastly different levels of fine motor development. So he's kind of, you know, indicating like they're smearing butter all over them, right? And so readers of Gourmet are probably going to be like, ew, this thing is kind of gross. This lobster festival is not really the place I want to be. And so by Foster Wallace describing it in this manner, he's establishing common ground with his audience. He does that really extensively here in this paragraph where he's saying, hey, I have the same kind of aesthetics as you do. So now that we are the same, we know that we're the same. I had this question when I was there. I couldn't help but ask this question. Is all this okay? He sets up all this commerce in the beginning, right? He talks about, like, you know, this is a well-marketed thing and it's 25,000 pounds of lobster. Look at all these things that we make with that lobster, and the whole kind of marketing, right, of this whole of the lobster with the you know, the t-shirts and the pool toys and all that kind of stuff. So this is a commerce event. This is a way of making money. And he ends up kind of asking this question later on. Is that ethical? Is it ethical to go through this whole thing just so that we can eat it? And that's what this whole second part of it is. So, because Foster Wallace knows his audience is going to be resistant to these questions, they're not going to want to ask these questions. He spends that whole first time just kind of showing, hey, I'm like you guys, I'm the same way, but now I've been left with these questions. And you're gonna see later on, he kind of really hammers this stuff home when we get to the last page of the article, when he sets up a part where he says, given this article's venue, right, that's Gourmet Magazine, and my own lack of culinary sophistication, he's always careful to tell his audience, hey, I'm not some sort of person coming into this with an agenda. Here he's saying, I'm not some sort of super big expert, chef. I'm just curious about whether the reader can identify with any of these reactions and acknowledgments and discomforts. I'm also concerned not to come off as shrill or preachy when what I really am is confused. And then here's his big thing. Given the possible moral status and very possible physical suffering of the animals involved, what ethical convictions do gourmets evolve that allow them not just to eat, but to savor and enjoy flesh-based viands? And so that really becomes this question, like why is this okay to do? And again, it's important for him to kind of make sure that he establishes credibility. So ethos is a key rhetorical appeal in this piece, because if he doesn't have credibility, they're not going to listen to him. And so that's a really important one to be thinking about as you're moving through this argument. So this argument, all of the classical appeals, logos, ethos, and pathos, are all highly present in this article. But I think of all of those, because of the nature of his resistant audience, ethos is going to be probably the most important thing that Foster Wallace has to do. He has to establish that he's credible with this audience. Okay, you guys, this video got a little bit longer than I wanted to. I love this article and I got really kind of involved here. I think this is a master stroke of rhetoric in this piece. I didn't even mention the footnotes, but I talk about the footnotes here in the comments. Footnotes are key to this argument. Foster Wallace is putting a lot of his important information into the footnotes, because remember, he sets up, it's all a matter of what your interests are. So he is just trying to get to that audience person who is curious and interested. Okay, you guys, I will end this video. Email me if you have any questions. And if you want, we can hold a Zoom session and we can talk about this article as well, because it's super awesome. Okay, talk to you guys later. Bye.